We want to talk about the topic of the providence of God. I don't know whether you have any idea what that word means, but you probably do if you look at the word carefully, because providence begins with the word provide. So it's providence, providence of God. Okay. What is the providence of God? It's the, I want to picture it this way, sovereign hand of God over all things, including nature, history, and your individual life. It's the sovereign hand that is over all things, including the nature, history, and your individual life. It is the sovereign hand that is at work and activities of God that provides, number one, and cares. Okay. Imagine if God does not provide air. Imagine God does not provide you strength. Imagine God does not provide another heartbeat. It's the provision of God. Okay. And secondly, it is also the hand of God that leads and guides, controls, and governs, okay, toward his purpose and what he set out to do. So let me summarize it again, okay? It is the sovereign hand of God that is over all things, including nature, history, which means nations, United States of America, this election, pandemic, economy, everything. Everything in it. And individualized for two things. Number one, to provide. Number two, to govern. Okay. Now, I want to go slow in the beginning because I want you to get that. He provides. So there is that fatherly love as the maker and as the Father. And also there is a second aspect, which is to govern. He is the king. He's the sovereign. Okay? So the providence of God encompasses really two main motifs. Okay? Two main motifs or themes. One is his provision, and the other one is his control or his governance. He governs. Okay? Ultimately, he governs. He provides for all the need of his creation as the maker and as the father, including air, including your breath, including your mental energy, including your strength, wisdom, everything. Okay. And secondly, he controls. Now, can you imagine 7 billion people living together on this earth without any sovereign control over it? That will be very messy, wouldn't it? Very, very chaotic. Okay, so two main motifs or the theme of providence of God is his provision and his governance, his governing motif. What is the this provision and control exert themselves in three main areas that we're going to be talking about? We already mentioned it. Number one, history. History is in God's hand. And that's how Scripture continues to attest, including nations, United States of America, Babylon, Soviet Union, okay? South Korea, name it, you name it, okay? Including the election, including the whole process of whatever is happening in this world right now, okay? And also, secondly, the nature. All the animates and inanimates, in other words, all the plants and all the animals, fish, all the animals in the world. Okay, and where do we see that? Do you remember the story of Jonah? Some of you know the story of Jonah. Some of you may not. You should read it. It's a great story, great salvation story of God. And there are two creatures that shows up that is in absolute sovereign providence of God. One is the big fish in chapter 2, and the other one is the worm that awakened Jonah in chapter 4. The greatest, one of the greatest animals in the world, and one of the smallest thing in the world. God is in absolute sovereign control over it. And lastly, history, nature, and individual lives. Your life too. Every step of the way, from the beginning to all the way to your death, where you live, who you're going to meet, which church you'll be attending, who will be your friends, who will be no longer your friends, and who will you will meet, whom you will marry. Okay, all these things is in the providence of God. The word providence actually literally means, get this, foresight, seeing beforehand. God foresees, foresight, so God looks ahead and therefore he provides. He is ready to provide. Now, could you hold with me? Just because he knows what is coming, he doesn't have to provide, does he? But he does, he provides. You know why? Because God is good, and this is fatherly love of the Maker. So that through his foreseeing, prevision, and providing the need, God infallibly carries the history to his teleologic end, to his purpose. Can you picture this? He's the king. He leads, guides, controls, and governs. And there are all kinds of sin, all kinds of interactions, all kinds of wars, all kinds of mess, but still his hand is over history and leading toward his end. And you are one of them. In fact, if you are in Christ, you are a very special, special one of them. So providence of God, sovereign God, is a pervasive idea in the scripture. And I would say these are the two big pillars of doctrine of God, sovereignty and providence. And it should give you real comfort if you are in Christ Jesus. Okay? And I want to give you maybe five basic principles related to this pervasive idea of providence of God. And these are big principles. If you could just listen carefully, I'm going to try to go over rather quickly. Number one, when we say the providence of God, God is sovereign in this universe, and he is in complete control of all things. The world is not in chaos right now. The world is not out of control. God is in absolute, complete control over all things, including history. Okay? Until his time is due, okay, he is going to lead and he's going to finish and everything is in order. In other words, nothing is able to stand up to him and defy him and do that which will defeat him in the end. No one. He's the sovereign. This is true on earth. Also, it is true among so-called gods, small gods. Okay? In fact, the Bible says there is no other gods, only idols, false gods. God alone is God in all the universe. And that's whom we are talking about right now. Okay? So second principle is the one and only God. We're talking about this, that sovereign God, one and only God, created the universe. Therefore, it's his. And everything in it are subject to him. It belongs to him and subject to him. This means it is impossible that anything or anyone, whether in heaven or on earth, or supernatural beings, kings, presidents, simple peasants, should imagine that they are self-sufficient and I am not answerable to God. You are. Okay? That's the principle. Third principle, which I think it is very, very interesting. Now listen to this. God, who alone is God, who created the universe, created the world, created the history, and he governs this world to his eternal purpose. It's not like a random. Now, I think that's going to just spin a lot of things differently. If you're one of those persons who are thinking about the big picture person, what in the world is happening in this country? Some of you may be thinking. Where is this going toward to? You know, we can't really figure it out. We have a hunch. We could kind of guess, but we don't know it. But one thing for sure, the God, the sovereign God we are talking about, has an eternal plan, and toward that end, it is moving toward to. Third principle. Fourth one is, I think, the key one, and I hope you will love this one. God's grand and ultimate will and purpose are realized in and through Jesus and Jesus alone. Until you meet him, you understand him, until he opens your eyes, unveil your eyes, you do not know the plan of God. You do not understand the plan of God. You do not know anything that is happening in this world. You just may have false impressions and false ideas. Okay. God's will is not some impersonal astral principle, but it is the saving purpose as a heavenly father. Can we just pause for a second? That's his plan. That's what the scripture says his plan is. If you were to ask me, what is the Bible about? What is the history about? I would put it this way. And I learned this from Billy Graham. Billy Graham said it is about saving his people through his son Jesus Christ. History is about saving his people through his son Jesus Christ. So God came to us into history, became one of us through the incarnation of the Son, which means God became a man. God-man, for our salvation and redemption, ultimately bring glory to God and salvation to his people. Okay? Those are always together. This is the plan of God, the purpose of God, which existed before your birth and before the foundation of the world. Now, would you think with me? Now, if that's true, in the time, at the moment of God's choosing, the world began. You didn't choose it. You had nothing to do with that, actually. In the moment of time of God's choosing, the world was created, the creation. And at the moment of God's choosing, Christ came and he completed his work and brought salvation. And at the same time, at the moment of God's choosing, he will bring it all to pass. Not just your life, but this nation, as well as history. That's called consummation. That's the providence of God. Okay? I know it's much bigger than us, isn't it? I know it's much bigger than our concerns, everyday concerns. But isn't it amazing? This is what the scripture teaches. At his time, at the moment of his God's choosing, he created the heavens and the earth. At the moment of God's choosing, Jesus came, okay, and finished his work and salvation. At the moment of God's choosing, he's coming back and he's going to consummate. It's going to apply to all of you as well, of course. Our individual lives as well. What's going to happen afterward? Bible clearly says he will draw all things to his son, to the glory of his son. Every knee shall bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus is the Lord. That's the big picture. Romans 11 verse 36 says, from him, through him and to him are all things. Okay. That is so liberating, isn't it? From him, through him, to him are all things. All about Christ. Okay. Fifth and last principle in relation to the this doctrine of providence of God is, although the plan of God has been revealed partially to us, in its totality, it remains as mystery. Here's what it means. Okay, although we see the big picture, but we do not have a capacity, we are not capable of grasping what it ultimately means in altogether, because God himself is ultimately behind us. In other words, we are not God. God remains that as mystery. Okay? And this is not to this is not designed to humiliate us, but to humble us. Because what that means is to find our place, appropriate place, and help us to realize you are not God. You need God. Okay? We are his creatures, and we are not God, which will call us to trust him, not to be on, up to, on the par level with him, but to trust him, right? And put faith in him and to obey him. And ultimately, our deepest prayer should be, may your will be done. Don't you feel like, I don't know where you are in life, you feel like that, don't you? Where is this going? Where is my life going? Where is my marriage going? Right? Ultimately, it's in God's hand, and may the will of God to be done. So, what is the extent of his providence? Sort of the review, but I want to just go over. Simply put, providence of God encompasses every aspect of the created order. Supernatural as well as natural. When we say supernatural, what are we talking about? Heaven, angels, worship, everything is a created order. Supernatural created order. Only God is not created. All of that is in the providence of God, as well as the natural things, which includes from the beginning to the end, heaven to earth, animate to inanimate, plant and animals, individual to the nations, ours to ages, weeds and wheat, birth and death, catastrophe to calmness. Everything within the loving presence and involvement of the Heavenly Father. It's everything is in his hand. That's what the scripture teaches. Okay? And according to his wisdom, infinite wisdom and power and his righteousness and his love, he hastening slowly, he leads, he controls, and he governs slowly to work out his own eternal purpose. Are you following? This is an amazing statement. We're talking about these doctrine of providence of God. If you understand this, and if you are a child of God, it's just going to bring amazing peace upon your heart. Okay? So God's involvement is three things. Number one, we already mentioned it. It's the nature. Okay? Number two, it is the history, including nations and individuals. And lastly, I want to just specially talk about individuals who put their faith in Christ Jesus. Okay? Three different things. That's what the scripture speaks about. First, natural order. And we already mentioned this, even the supernatural order, created order, heavens and angels and worship, everything that is happening in supernatural realm, it's in the providence of God. God rules. God governs. And also it includes natural created order, including animals and the plants, sun, moon, stars, clouds, morning dew, frost, hail, lightning, rain, thunder, and wind. By the way, all of these are in the scripture. All of these are in the scripture. Okay? And all subject to, they are all subject to God's command. Even the earth is. You know, we're living on this planet called Earth. Earth is in the providence of God. So earthquakes, famines, droughts, fire, plagues, pandemic. That's what plague is, isn't it? It's in the providence of God toward his purpose. Calamities, floods, all the forces of nature are subject to the sovereign word of God, sovereign power of God, who works out his will through them. Okay? And God has control over plants and animals, trees and grass and flowers and crops and all God's benevolent care, and birds and fish in God's providential care. Okay? And animals, everything in it, in God's. So nature is in God's providence. Secondly, God's providence is over the history of human and the nations. And we see the God's involvement on history, particularly through the nation of Israel, but throughout all the nations. Bible makes it clear that God rules the destiny of all the people on the earth, including Philistines and Jebusites, now Koreans, Russians, Africans, Americans. It's in the hand of God. Acts chapter 17 states an amazing statement. I love this statement. And this is the message that Paul preached when he went to Athens. Mars Hill. Actually, I've been there. It's an amazing place. And there is Acropolis, police right behind him, which is intimidating. And he stood there, and he spoke to these scholars of that time, basically preaching about this sovereign God. And this is what he said to them. God has planned the time and boundary of all people of all nations. You know what that means? The Chinese people are living in China because God placed them there. Okay? Puritans came to the United States 400 years ago because God moved them here. Some of you are born in this country, maybe you weren't, but now in 21st century, in 2020, you are living in New York because God set the time and the boundary. It's an amazing statement, isn't it? Of all the people and of all the people group. I came to this country 44 years ago. So most of my life, I lived in New York. Before, I lived in the small country called Korea. I don't know where I will end up, when I will finish my life, but Bible is clearly saying the time and the boundary has been set by the sovereign hand of God. Would you think with me? How many people do you really know in your life? How many people do you really know in your life? Would you say you know about 100 people really well? Which will be pretty impressive. If you know 100 people really well, that's pretty impressive. Probably less than that. Right? Out of 7 billion people, you know maybe 20 people really well. And who designed that? Who orchestrated that? How did you end up in New Heart? Out of like so many churches, how did you end up being a friend of Paul? Out of all the guys, there are so many more cool people. How did you end up being a friend of Paul? How did you end up marrying your husband? It's the providence of God. leading, guiding, directing. See, here's what I'm trying to say. So that 20, 30 people that you know really well in your life are very, very special people in your life. That makes sense? And that's the people that we are called to love. You have one spouse in your lifetime. Hopefully that's the case, right? And this is one special person out of 7 billion people God has provided, because God foresaw and provided with a fatherly love, right? And it's an amazing thing to think about. You know, I was thinking about this week. We don't have a huge church, and many have come and gone. And some are with us, and some are not. And I was thinking, wow, that's a very, very special relationship. Out of all the people in New York City, out of all the people that are existing, these are the people that I am called to be a close friends as a church. That's the providence of God, right? God's involved with individuals. We know he was involved with Israel. In the Old Testament, Israel was chosen by God as his people, and it was guided by God in a very specific way. Quickly, it included the call of Abraham. One individual, right? Abraham, Isaac, and then Jacob, and then 12 sons, and that became the nation. Do you begin to see the picture? The patriarchs, and then Egyptian slavery, redemption from Egypt, parting of the Red Sea, going through the wilderness for 40 years, and the drama, right? Entering into Canaan, fighting of Jericho, right? And Gibeonites, and guidance and sustenance during this time, and history of Israel of judges and kings and the drama, right? And remember, because they have abandoned God, exile and the judgment came upon them. God's hand is upon the nation. Not only Israel, God also guides the destinies of all the nations of the world, including United States of America. United States of America is not going to be eternal. No nation will be eternal. Only the kingdom of God will be eternal. God is their king and the ruler. Ultimately, he is the king and he's the ruler. And he has foreseen all that will take place. And I was thinking about this statement this week. With all the crazy things and all the information that you hear from the media, God has foreseen all that will take place in the course of time. Who's going to win the election? How it's going to pan out? He has seen everything. And he guides the national, you know, destinies of the people of the earth. And using all of these for his purpose, he makes and chooses as to who will do what. Did you know that? Will he raise Mr. Trump? Or will he raise Mr. Biden? It's all in the hand of God for his glorious purpose, for the accomplishment of his purpose on earth in history. Okay. Third and final, his hand is upon individuals. That includes your life. If you read the Bible, we read big picture, but we see a lot of individual life stories, don't we? Story of Joseph. Story of David. Story of Elijah. Story of certain kings, Jehoshaphat. Story of Paul. We hear a lot of personal stories. Not only his hand is upon the big, big things, but God's hand is upon individual life. Every aspect of human life is included in God's providential orderings. Formation, growth, existence, fortune, destiny of the world as a whole, as a nation, but so it is with the individuals. Your formation, your birth, your growth, your existence, and your fortune, and your destiny. How did I end up going to Stony Brook University? Man, if you ask me personally, it's a funny story. I went because my friend went. Can you believe that? I went because my friend went there. I never visited the school. I went there on the day of school is starting. That's how I ended up at Stony Brook University many years ago. And that's where I met Jesus. And my friends left the school. Can you believe that? It's the providence of God. Birth, growth, existence, fortune, destiny. How did I end up marrying my wife who was so many years younger than me? I mean, you know, how did I end up planting a church, meeting you, worshiping God? Every step of the way, it is the hand of God that is over my life. God formed us in the womb, Bible says. He ordained us what all lives should be. He guides us in our life and circumstances. And He meets our need. Okay, whatever your need is. Okay, sometimes it looks impossible, but He meets our needs. And He sends wealth and adversities in your life for His good purpose. Okay, ultimately, He's going to take us off of this world in His time. Okay, can you imagine your date of departure of this world has been scheduled, not in Google calendar, but in God's calendar. That's the providence of God. How do we respond to this? Are you anxious? Or are you comforted? Do you feel nervous or do you feel confident? Depends on who this God is, right? Nothing is left to chance. Heavenly Father guides on our lives. I love the story of Joseph, but for time's sake, I'm not going to review it. But do you remember this verse in chapter 50, verse 20? You intended to harm me, but God intended for good. Your life may look miserable to your human eyes, but God's plan superseding that sin and mess and all kinds of chaos is good. It's good. Romans 8:28 says, and we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose. Okay. Finally, there's a special providence for those who put their trust in Him. The believers, Christians. Our time are in His hand. He is directing our steps, and throughout our lives, there is a special deliverance from evil and calamities because we are His children. Right? There is a favor. There is that favor that we don't deserve, but because we are His children, there is that general love, and then there is that special love as a children of God. Right? And preservation and protection and blessing and strength and the eternal destiny of all human beings is in the hand of God. Okay? I know I'm taking a little bit long today, but I want to talk about gospel connection. Stay with me because it's so good. I promise you, this is so good. Providence of God is about foreseeing and providing, but it is pictured in the Bible with a father and a son story. Are you ready for this? Father and a son story. I'm taking you to, obviously, Genesis chapter 22, where Abraham had one son, one legitimate son. His name was Isaac. And God, for some peculiar reason, tested Abraham and asked him to sacrifice Isaac, his son, his only son, whom he loved. Okay? It was the most difficult test of his life. Father and a son story. So next morning, Abraham and Isaac went on a 3-day journey with his servants and arrived at the mountain of Moriah. Remember that? Abraham told at that point the servants to stay behind and said to them, I and the boy, Isaac, will go and worship to make sacrifice, and we will come back. Did you hear that? He was going there to sacrifice his son as a burnt offering. And he said, I and the boy will go to go and worship, and we will come back. Did he mean it, or was he lying? Then Abraham and Isaac walk up that hill. Now, please go, picture with me. This is father and a son walking up the mountain of Moriah. Just alone, Abraham the father will sacrifice his son, and father is carrying the knife and the fire. What is he going to do with that? He's going to slaughter him, and he's going to burn him. And the father put the wood that they're going to use to burn upon the son's shoulder. And we see that in Genesis 22. Can you imagine the emotion and fear and the tension? Then Isaac opened his mouth in verse 7, my father. And Abraham said, here I am, my son. And Isaac said this heart-wrenching question. Behold, the fire and the wood we have, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? Abraham said, amazingly, God will provide. God will providence. For himself, the lamb, for a burnt offering, my son. And they went up to the top of the mountain. And it was Abraham the father, built the altar, laid the wood, and bound his son Isaac, and laid him on the altar. Can I just repeat that? He built the altar, he put the wood, and he bound his son, he tied him up, and he laid him there, and ready to slaughter him. Abraham reached out, took his knife to slaughter his son. Okay. However, God, intervened and stopped Abraham in a very dramatic way. Abraham, 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 now I know you fear me, seeing you have not withheld your son, your only son, for me. Do you remember that? And then Abraham lifted up his eyes and looked and saw behind him there was a ram, male lamb, caught in a thicket by his horn. How did that happen? Lord provided in a very timely fashion. This is the story of father and the son, and father providing the providence, provision of the lamb. Right? Lord divinely, miraculously, timely providing a ram. So Abraham called that place. Remember the name of the place? Jehovah, the Lord will provide. Yahweh Jireh. Okay? On the mountain of the Lord it shall be provided. Jehovah Jireh, or Yahweh Jireh. Lord will provide. 3,000 years later, there is another story of a father and a son. Okay? In the New Testament, the gospel of Jehovah Jireh, of the Lamb. It's about God's providence providing a lamb saw the need of humanity and providing the lamb for the sacrifice to bring peace between the Heavenly Father and the humanity. Philippians chapter 4, verse 19 says, "My God will supply or provide all my needs, all your needs, according to his riches in glory and in Christ Jesus." Father and the Son walk up the hill together. It wasn't the mountain of Moriah, but it was at the exact same region of mountain of Moriah, but it is now called mountain of Calvary. It's the same region. Okay? Father and the Son walking up the hill together, and the Son asking, "I see the knife and I see the fire, but where is the lamb?" And I could almost hear Father speaking, "The Lord will provide." Right? It was the Father who placed the wood upon the shoulder of the Son. But it was the Father who carried the knife and the fire himself. And it was the Father who built the altar. It was the Father who put the wood upon him, bound him. And unlike the story of the Old Testament, this time Father allowed the Son to be sacrificed. It was the Father. That's the story of God's providence, isn't it? Just as the ram in Genesis 22, God provided, took Isaac's place, Jesus, the Lamb of God, took your place and my place. So the Father provided a lamb for seeing the need of humanity, the greatest need of humanity, the greatest need of humanity, and he provided fully toward his purpose of saving his people for the glory of God. That's his providence. Okay, let me conclude. It's God's nature as our loving Father to provide. Isn't it great, people? Why are you so anxious? What you will eat, what you will drink, and what you will wear. Why are you so anxious? Jesus saying, do not be anxious. But in everything, let your request known unto God by prayer and petition with thanksgiving. Thanksgiving is coming, people, right? Because God foresees the need. And God provided. And it is the cross, the sacrifice of the Son, the Lamb of God, for us, confirms the doctrine of providence. I mean, if you are in doubt, look at the cross with the greatest certitude. It was on the cross he demonstrated clearly the providence of God, the provision of God. And I was reminded of this verse. He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up, provided for us all, will he not? How will he not also with him graciously give us, provide us all things? Does that make sense at all, people? He who did not spare his own Son, but gave him up for us all, as this Lamb of God, on my behalf, right? How will he not also with him graciously provide us providence, all things? So what is our response? How do we respond, especially during this Thanksgiving season? And my prayer is that may we fall in love with this Father and the Son. Not their gifts, not the gifts that Father gives, but may we fall in love with the Father and the Son through the Spirit. Respond him in worship and trust Him. Trust Him. Not partially, right? Not partially, but trust Him with thanksgiving. And I think this is this ought to be the ultimate response. Just as He has provided His Son, may we offer our life as a whole, as a living sacrifice unto Him. Come on, brothers and sisters. Romans chapter 12, verse 2. Do not conform any longer to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by renewing of your mind. And then you'll be able to test and approve what will of God is. You know what the will of God is? Offer your life as a living sacrifice. As a living sacrifice. Okay. Let's pray together.